Yo, it's Mel from Rap Rankings. To hear the full episode this clip comes from and all the other episodes, stop by raprankings.com or search Rap Rankings on your favorite podcast platform.
Well, we already got a special guest joining us, our first of two guests this episode.
Oh, yeah.
And this is this is an extra special guest because for the very first time, Mools and Mel are getting into business with a third party, if you will.
Oh, listen, I got to leave it to me. You're not hype enough. We got a sponsor, folks.
That's
the
right.
Very first one.
So we got a sponsor here, folks. And I thought long and hard about sponsorship and what it means in terms of this show, not wanting to advertise with products that don't connect to us. Therefore, we don't think it would connect to our audience. The usual podcast.
I mean, I don't know if like people. Penis enhancement would connect for me because I've never been in a position to use it. But, you know, it would make more sense to have a rap centric sponsor is what you're saying.
At least for our very first sponsor, you know, make a statement. And today we have none other than the creator of the hip hop debate game. So what's the scenario? Please, ladies and gentlemen, give a round of applause to our friend, Kenny Smith.
Thank you. Glad to be here, guys. Appreciate you guys having me on.
Here we go, yo. Here we go, yo. Hey. So what's the scenario? Here we go, yo.
Very fitting.
That was Amul's original idea. Very spirited entrance theme.
Kenny, how you doing?
Good. I'm glad to be on, guys. It's an honor to be here with you guys, especially for this particular episode. Scarface is one of my favorites. But more importantly than that, you know, like you guys said, a fitting partnership, relationship, however you want to call it. What you guys do is within my vein and within my wheelhouse. And when I heard about you guys, I was, you know, definitely interested. And you guys have become one of my regular podcasts that I listen to. So it only makes sense that, you know, we get together and, you know, partner up. So I'm here.
Word.
We're very happy to have you with us. And, to start this partnership, I mean, we're going to talk a little bit more about the game and where we come in with that a little bit later on. But I mean, you're a fan of the show. You're familiar with the rating system. Mel, for maybe some people who are listening to the first time, though, should we run through it one more time?
Yeah, sure. You know, especially as we got a new face. You know, I was thinking about this actually when I was this has nothing to do with anything, but when I was in the Target bathroom earlier this week, and I was like, you know, usually we, you know, go through the rating system when we have a new guest, you know, in case they bring in like new listeners, you know, first time on the show. But I was thinking if they're already fans of the show, they probably wouldn't need us to go through it, you know. But I think given this situation, you know, first sponsor, it's a big, I want to go through it in case, you know, yeah, we should go through it. So
let's do it.
Yeah, let's do it. Wow, it's been a minute. We kind of automated this process not too long ago. So
Hit us with a live, as Jesse would say, spontaneous read.
Nice. Yeah, live read, man. Like, yeah, no. All right, I got to remember how to do this. Okay, here we go. The rating system is simple. Each song is rated on a scale of 1 to 10. These numbers do not reflect the quality of a song, as that is indeterminable. Instead, each number reflects a level of enjoyment. In short, here's what each number means. 10 means, this is a perfect song to me, one of my favorite songs of all time. 9 means, I love it. 8 means, I like it a lot. 7 means, I like it. 6 means, it's all right. I don't dislike it, but I can't say that I like it. 5 means, I feel practically nothing about this. 4 means, it's not the worst thing I've ever heard, but I dislike it. 3 means, I dislike it. 2 means I hate it, and 1 means I absolutely can't stand it, one of the worst things I've ever heard. Side note, You may hear us on this show add a plus or a minus to those numbers. Understand that the pluses and minuses have no mathematical or statistical value. They are merely indicators that mean one of two things. One, it's like saying a stronger light version of that number. 6+, strong 6, 8-, light 8. Second thing is it's an indicator it could go up or down in the future. We have a segment dedicated to, changing ratings on this show called I Was Fucking Tripping. So if we come in one week and we realize we were fucking tripping, you know, the rating could change and it would be updated on the board, you know, on raprankings.com. And yeah, that's pretty much how it works. That's how you do it, right? Is this the rating system? It's been a minute.
Yeah, that's the rating system. And I mean, really all they need to know are the numbers. So what the numbers correspond to for right. this exactly. portion of it. Sometimes I say Bobby, you know, when he says lastly.
Oh, it's been a long time since you've said that. The Bobby Lashley. That's for the, yeah, that's deep rap rankings lore. But hey, the rating system is on raprankings.com. So, yeah.
So with that being said, and Kenny, with you as our guest today, would you like to offer up your rate, or rather, Mel, do you want to set the table here?
Yeah, I would like to set the table. Y'all just go dig right in. You know? All right. Well, listen, we're here. We're gathered here today to do track 3 on The Fix, Scarface of The Fix, which is In Cold Blood, produced by Kanye West. So, yeah, we like to leave it up to the guests. Do you want to provide a rating first? Should we go first? However you want to do it.
I'll go first.
Okay.
I've been teetering with this for the whole week so far, but I've also been waiting to say this all week. I'm going to give this an A plus. Ding okay. me, baby.
Gotta love it.
Nice.
Gotta fucking love it.
You're the first guest to use Moles' catchphrase.
I love
this
it.
This is great. Well.
All right. Well, all right. Shit. I'm honored, and I'd be happy to give my next rating, because it will come with a ding me baby of a flat wow. 8.
Mm. Oh, okay.
Well, wait, hold on. Let me double check. I didn't actually look at my rating. No, 8 plus. Mules and Kenny connect.
Yes.
Okay. Wow. I'm always in this position. This always happens to me these days. I just... Okay, well... Before I provide my rating, I just want to say one correction, because I know Jesse's probably mad. He's like, I'm pretty sure Jesse has said ding me, baby, which wouldn't make Kenny the first guest. But the thing is, Jesse's not really a guest. He's the third member. So mm-hmm. technically, I'm still correct, you know? So anyway, Kenny's the first guest to say it. So, but anyway, yeah, I'm stalling because I'm afraid to give my rating because I don't want to get jumped. I've been getting jumped for seasons now. I feel like ever since
I'm not going to get the sponsor to jump. You.
How do I know that? Okay, I
mean,
can't trust you.
Maybe if you try to bury the song we're going on with our next guest, me and the guest will bury you. He's a real Houstonian, you know? But well, look, we're business partners here, guys. All right. We're not jumping each other. We're getting to the bag, baby.
Oh yeah, that proverbial bag. Well, here's the thing. Hopefully I don't end up in a body bag when y'all kill me in cold blood, because I give it a 6+. But here's the thing, it's not Scarface's fault. I'm gonna get into it, obviously. I have to explain myself. But 6+. You know, and of course, as I just say, it could go up in the future.
Well, yeah, if it's not his fault, then whose fault is it?
Kanye, but we'll get there. It's Kanye's
That's
fault.
Crazy, because I think this is one of the better Kanye beats of this era.
Can I and say, see, I think this is the best beat on the album.
Oh,
personally,
wow.
For me.
Okay.
Huh. Kenny, it goes there for me at points. When it goes into that little like bridge portion of
the
beat, where
instrumental break, where it's like, yeah.
It's the most Scarface sounding beat, I think. For Scarface and how, and you know what he talks about, and you know how he is. It's the most Scarface sounding beat, I think.
Mm. Okay, I would have to take your word for that, because like I'm only slightly familiar with Scarface, so it's like. Okay. Hey, if this fits him, it fits him. But like,
I think it's a good middle ground between Scarface's style and Kanye's sample-driven style at the time.
Yeah. agree.
Well, you know what's interesting? I couldn't tell this was Kanye until, you know, I was sitting down writing my notes and I'm like, you know, looking in Discogs and everything. I'm like, Kanye, you know, because mm-hmm. like mm-hmm. the other beats on the album that he, I can tell it's Kanye. It has that sort of early career Kanye quality where it's like, you know, how would I describe
it? Right, like Guess Who's Back, which is the next song. We'll get into that more later. But like that sounds like a Kanye beat to me.
It has the explosive drums like y'all talked about last week.
Right.
Yes.
He bit the explosive drums. And Kanye's programming is like a certain way in this era where it's like, I don't want to say the drum. They're not thin drums, but like it's they rattle more than they knock, mm-hmm. I guess. You know, which isn't an issue with me. I'm sure when we get to College Dropout, Mools has a very controversial take about that album. So when we discuss it, that'll be fun. But yeah, it's like I couldn't even tell this was Kanye, you know. And so this is how I feel. You know, Kenny, you said this is one of, you know, your favorite beat on the album. It's not a bad beat. I want to be clear there. It's not like I don't hate this beat at all. Like, I don't think it's anywhere like near remotely being bad. But my main issue with it is I like Scarface a lot on here, and I feel like the beat doesn't quite match the hunger and the content that Scarface is bringing to the record. And it's like there are other songs on the album where I'm like, okay, this beat is perfectly congruent with what's being talked about. This one almost feels like a little too cheery for these tales that Scarface is telling on here. I mean, not to get too ahead of myself, but a lot of this is very evocative to me. Like, you know, verse one, I've never been anywhere near selling drugs, but it's hard to not be right there with him when it's like, you know, full of formaldehyde, my clothes reeking marijuana, cops rolling up on us, my neighborhood's like a sauna. I mean, I'm right there with them, you know, and it's, you say lines, pistol gripping, ensuring won't nobody run up on us, but if they do, fucking, we murderous nigga, dome them. I'm kind of just like, that is very direct, you know, very straightforward. And I feel like this beat is, while not bad, is kind of soft in comparison to what's being talked about. I mean, I might sound totally crazy right now. I'm used to it. I mean, everybody thinks I'm crazy.
I would disagree. And I would say that I think Scarface might disagree with you too, only because if you're familiar with Scarface, there's a couple of different callbacks to some classic Ghetto Boy songs on this track.
Okay.
Particularly, he starts off, I start small time. Dope. That's a callback to where Scarface got his name, the original Ghetto Boy song from 1990. And it was called Scarface, Mr. Scarface, I believe. So that's where Scarface, before that he was Brad or Action. So I imagine that when he heard this, he's thinking to himself, oh shit, this brings me back to that time.
Right, okay.
This brings me back to, you know, and you know, so there's a couple other ones. Call back to some classic Ghetto Boy songs. I get a totally different feel for this. I get it's funky. I think it's one of the funkier beats on the album. And like you said, Kanye has a more soulful palette when he's constructing, you know, like with Guess Who's Back. This doesn't, like you said, this doesn't sound like a Kanye. This is more in the vein for me of The Truth with Beanie Siegel, where it doesn't really sound like a Kanye beat, but it's hard, and I get that feeling from this one. If this isn't the best beat, I can't think of one of a beat on this album that's harder than this beat. So I totally disagree with that one, but
okay,
I get it.
All right, huh? Okay, so
I think this album comes in pretty hard with "Safe" into "In Cold Blood."
Yeah, can I talk about that for a second? I actually the sequencing, I didn't think about that until recently, but the sequencing of these tracks is interesting because if you listen to "Safe," he's warning you about the cutthroat dudes in the drug game. And then you go to In Cold Blood and he personifies exactly what he spoke against in Safe. It's kind of interesting when I hear it. I'm listening to it like, wait, you just told us like to watch out for these dudes, and now you are the dude in Cold Blood. Like, you know, he's calling the dude that he got the dope from and telling him that he's locked up so that he can keep the dope. Like, that's as cutthroat as it can get. So yeah, I find it funny that I like the beat for Safe is an intro sounding beat. So I see why he sequenced it that way. But hearing the content of the two tracks, I'm like, well, I feel like maybe In Cold Blood should have been first, but who knows? Mm.
Okay. Well,
interesting.
Yeah.
There's, all right. Even in this, I mean, we're not quite there yet, but like you look at Guess Who's Back is almost this bridge between the Safe and In Cold Blood, and then the My Block. You know, like there's a tension. There's maybe one or two missteps with the sequencing that I'll point out later on, but for the most part, there's a lot of attention to sequencing on this thing.
Yeah.
Can I play a little bit of In Cold Blood? Because
sure.
I mean, I've actually sat with it all week.
Unless are you playing it just for the beat?
Yeah.
Play the one that I put in the folder. It's a freestyle, 50 Cent and Lloyd Banks, over In Cold Blood.
Oh, okay. This is what
it's from the Kanye West audio. I'm Good mixtape.
The G-Unit Soldier strikes again. Never missing an opportunity to plug 50. I see. Okay.
As long as you're just using it as an example to point out the beat, you know?
Fair enough. All right. Well, here, let's check it out.
Man, I figured I'd drop in. Blessing with a little short change to go shopping. Uh-huh. Wasn't on work. Elevator shitty, staircase busy. Your sister and I hugging on a nigga, she missy. Mama living room, he sipped Christie till he was pissy. Told niggas tried to blaze me last night, but they missed me. In the CL, so niggas wet the driver's side door. I had my vest on, I put the fucking pedal to the floor. I saw facing up, Lexington and Marcy hurrying. They be hollering like 50, let us put some work in. Today's a nice day, and this is a nice night. Somebody gon' die. It is what it is, my nigga. Why ask why? See, I stay in some shit in the street, but the niggas uptown love me like they love Pistol Pete. You heard me? Right? That nigga see that, nigga.
Small time, dope game, pushing on the corner, 20 cent cooker, 50 flippers if you want them, full of formaldehyde, my clothes reeking marijuana, cops rolling up on us, my neighborhood's like a sauna, pistol gripping, the jury won't nobody run up on us, but if they do, fuck them, we murderers, nigga, dope them, I ain't playing no games, I'm on a mission for the change, motherfuck me in the name, I'm 10 toes in the game. I can't slip this.
See, now here's the thing in relation to Safe. You know, the previous track. This one, like I was saying, it's not a bad beat. It's a good beat. The word I would use, this isn't a word at all, but it's a little pimpy.
Yeah.
Like a little swanky more so than like hard. You know?
All right. I like
it. It's like Scarface who takes it and makes it hard though.
Right. And that's the thing. Because everything Scarface is rapping about feels very hard. Where I feel like the Safe beat was hard. Like, kind of assaultive, very thick and deep and ominous. Whereas this, I feel like I'm more like stepping out the, you know, the car, like looking kind of fly.
Definitely
like,
gives me El Dorado vibes, El Dorado Cadillac vibes.
Right.
Yeah, definitely. Okay.
You know, so yeah,
I love that xylophone sound in the beat, by the way, as well.
Oh, that. Yeah. Right. Something you touched on though, Kenny, as far as like the content and how, you know, this follows right after Safe. What I think about specifically in terms of like, he's doing the whole cautionary thing on Safe, you know, telling you, you know, what to watch out for, how your homeboy crack your safe. Don't do this. Don't do that. Specifically on this song, verse 3, which is my favorite verse of the song. I don't know how anyone else feels about that, but, it's very striking because he basically is the guy on the other hand, like, except, like he knows what his fate is, you know, no more petty rock hustling. I'm going to be murdered for this shit that I've done. But I'm going to die standing up because I'm a stand up nigga, fuck down like a bitch on my knees. I'm a killer. So don't nobody cry because I was destined to get it. I mean, rappers can be striking and poignant, of course. Happens all over hip hop. But with something about this sequence where I'm like, I feel like you rarely get the guy just straight up admitting, like, listen, you know, it's just a matter of time. Like, people are aware of what comes with, you know, the drug game and being in the streets and that, but it's like, I mean, there's just a tone, and maybe it's Scarface's voice too. There's just like, I don't even feel like a hint of sadness. It's like, I wouldn't even use the word resignation. It's kind of like, it's everything short of like welcoming it. It's not like he's happy that this is going to be his end, but it's kind of just like an afterthought for him. It's like, oh, you already know it's going to end like that. Like, you know? So it makes the line that much more impactful, or the lines that much more impactful to me.
And cold blood. Yeah. And cold blood.
Right. And cold. Right. It's cold. Like, it's just.
You stop just short of what I feel like, for me personally, is the best bar on the whole album. I turned a dream into reality with a fuck you mentality, silencing mm-hmm. all the niggas in the neighborhood who challenged me. Like, right. I was hard. I was like, whoo. Like,
you know? that fuck you mentality, yeah. You know? Like, that's identifiable. Mm-hmm. I think we've all been there in some respect, you know? So it's, yeah, I mean, he's standing on this, man. Like, and it was like, the first time I heard this, I was like in the car and I was just like, man, like, I don't know if I personally would be this accepting like of my fate. Like, you know, most people like fight against it whether they're aware of it or not. You know, you're trying to prolong your life, you're trying to prevent an end like this. You know, I think of, you know, his name Scarface, you know, the movie Scarface. It's almost kind of similar, like the way Tony Montana went out, like kind of the same sort of attitude. It's like, yeah. All right, look, yeah. I don't get a fear of death from this guy. It's more so right. It's just,
you which know, is, I think that, I think that's why he has the callbacks to some. The other one was what is it? He says, destroy everything in the way of me seeing first motherfucking light of the day. That's a callback to a Ghetto Boys track. This is a quintessential Scarface track, and I think when he heard this beat, this is just maybe he might have had it written already. I don't know, but I think when he heard this beat, it took him back to, you know, early 90s, late 80s Ghetto Boys, when he was just becoming Scarface, and some of the visualization and, you know, all the things that make up who Scarface from the drug game street side, what he is, you know what I mean? I think it just took him all the way back to that, and that's why you got what you got here.
All right. Okay, I mean, that makes total sense to me, because, you know, coming from being a rapper, I would never argue with, you know, a beat bringing somebody to a place and them just, you know, following the beat to that place. Because, mm-hmm. you know, how I might have approached this is totally, like, if this beat brought him to a place in his mind or a place in time, you know, clearly it was a strong enough place to give me bars that I totally rock with, mm-hmm. you know? So that's why I'm kind of like on the border with this.
Because I like the beat, but you just don't think it's appropriate for the bars, basically.
Right. But with Kenny's input, I'm kind of thinking it's like, well, if this was something that he heard and he's like, this brought him to this place to give me these bars that I have no issue with, then maybe I should, you know, listen, like, okay, imagine I'm Scarface and what about this beat maybe would have brought him to this place?
I would,
you know,
I would implore you to listen to Ghetto Boys Scarface.
And that would probably be
because it's a similar beat. It's not a hard gangster beat, but it's sort of on the pimp, side. And it starts off the same way. I started small time dope game. So I think you're right in the sense that, you know, this is, it doesn't entirely match up with, you know, with the content, but what I think what Scarface was going for was what he has done already and what he's one of the best at.
Right.
Is, you know, laying it down on this type of beat.
And, you know, that would make sense, too, sequence-wise, because this is pretty, you know, near the top of the album. So, you know, he would still be establishing, like, this is kind of be the place to do the callback or kind of appeal to the core fan base. It's like, you know, you don't want to have to make them wait too deep in the album to get, you know, what they recognize or maybe have came for, you know. So, yeah, I'm going to have to listen to the Ghetto Boy song. Because, I mean, look, this 6+, like, I could come back next week and be like, yeah, I was tripping. You know, because I don't have an issue with the bars at all. I mean, verse 3 is one of my favorite verses across the whole album. Verse 2 was very fun. Like, you touched on it earlier, but that was humorous to me. Like, specifically how he starts, because, you know, I've never cooked work ever in a kitchen, but when he's like, I got a brick from a sucker that he wanted to move, but the whole time while I'm cooking, I'm like, fuck this dude. That was hilarious to me, because, like,
he has a very dark sense of humor because he delivers everything in the, like, in that deep register,
right? Mm-hmm.
But you know, it works. He's very funny. But even to your point, Kenny, I think about the Ghetto Boys song "Mind Playing Tricks on Me." They're, you know, maybe their biggest record, and I think about that
also Scarface beat. Produced.
Yes, that beat though, that could have been a Souls of Mischief song. That could have been a Far Side song. It's what they do with the beat that makes it unique to me. It's like, that's almost Tempo Man adjacent, that beat, and yet it's the most depressive song, like lyrics contrasting with the beat.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, this is, this might, I might be just having a whippersnapper Mel moment. Yeah, Mel ain't rap. Hashtag Mel ain't rap. I mean, look, I'm rap, but yeah, I have my blind spots. It's like, I've never heard a Ghetto Boys album. So yeah, this could totally be in line with what we've been getting from Scarface, and I wouldn't know.
Right. You know? But so my opinion of this, I think if you further familiarize yourself with, like, Scarface, you listen to Ghetto Boys, you listen to The Diary by Scarface, you start to take in more of his stuff, then you can unlock some stuff here that may sound foreign to you right now.
Right, because, like, all I could really compare this to was other tracks on the album where it's like, okay, these lyrics match this beat. Yeah. So this felt like an outlier in comparison to those. But if I go through his whole catalog, I might hear more of this, and it's like, oh, this is standard for him.
Yeah.
All right, so if that's the case, you know, okay, well. Oh, look, future, I'm this long glad to be here. I'm learning. Audit. I'm learning every week, you know?
A future audit. This is a... It's coming.
I mean, there's an audit at the end of every season, you know. I usually go through everything again. I mean, spoiler, I enjoy this album quite a bit, so I wouldn't be surprised if this went up, you know, because I'm, like I said, I'm on board with everything he's saying. You were talking about the instrumental sort of section earlier. I think it comes perfectly after, like, his final lines of the first verse. It's like, I'm the real live version of the Corleone family. That break is kind of Godfather-esque to me.
Yes, like, it is.
You know,
but there's also something kind of haunting about it as well.
Yeah.
And it's got that, you know, the shimmery, like, almost like wind chime sounds in there.
Yeah.
And it builds up to a crescendo to drop the beat back in. And Face has enough emphasis in his delivery for me to say, yo, this dude knew exactly what to do with this beat, when to let it breathe, when to attack it. Very good.
Right.
Very, very good record, in my opinion.
Something
my second
I wanna,
favorite.
Interesting. Something I want to add, the song, the way that the verses are structured and the hook is structured is very interesting. He starts off, and he does this a couple of different times on the album. He starts off with a 16-bar verse. And then he has that little interlude bridge, you know, I'm the real live version, which is 2 bars.
Yeah.
And then he goes right into the second verse for 4 bars.
Right. And then it kind of
and then he jumps into the hook. Yeah.
Right.
He jumps into that one wrong move, and I'm gonna have to leave you for your goons, catch you slipping asleep in your bedroom. Then
and then boom. And so then, what the fuck? And so then he jumps into the hook after that. Then you get the hook, And then he goes for another 16 bars. Right. And then he drops the hook again. So it's he does that on a couple. He does that on I think two or three different songs where it's like a teaser. He like teases like a hook right. or another verse, or he doesn't give you the whole hook. He might give you part of the hook, and then he'll give you the whole hook later. I think I don't know why he does that or why he chose to do that on this album, but it's kind of cool.
It's cool. Yeah, it's interesting though. Like, I definitely took note of that kind of structuring because, you know, on first listen, it kind of felt like I didn't even catch the refrain. It kind of felt like right. one long story.
Right. Right.
And then on repeated listens, I'm like, oh, okay, that was the hook.
Yeah.
You know, it's always fun to hear things like that because I know, you know, being a rapper, like when I first started, because I didn't want to mess up. I just wanted to do everything right. I was very rigid. It's like 16, hook, 16, hook, 16, hook. I'm out of here, you know? And then I kind of learned, well, you can do an 8 here, do a little brief intermission and come back and do that. Like, so it's always fun to hear people play with this and not just play with it, because sometimes it can, you know, it can have a structure, but it can seem so disorienting that it throws you off.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas I think here it works because once you go through the song a few times, it's like it becomes familiar to you. It's like, okay, there's right. this part, then this. You right. know, so
I wonder to myself, all right, did Kanye give him a beat that was already laid out with 16 hook, 16 hook, 16? Or were they together and Scarface said, fuck it, I'm going to do what I want. And Kanye then later had to work around what Scarface did. Because if you listen to the song and you listen to some parts of the beat, it sounds like some parts of the beat might be meant for the hook, but Scarface is rapping.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so I kind of wonder how.
I've been in studios where I've brought beats in, and the engineer will re-chop the beat sometimes in the Pro Tools.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, put it to the grid, the tempo, and
sometimes they might fuck with the arrangement though of things. They'll right. move stuff around. They'll like lock it yeah. into the tempo, yeah. move stuff around. So it's possible.
If I had to guess, I would say Scarface probably took liberties with it.
Yeah, I mean, that embellishment that I was talking about, that sort of bridge part in the beat,
mm-hmm.
I feel like 2002 Kanye was not putting that in his beats yet.
Right, know, yeah, which is why I was shocked to find out.
It sounds like Kanye. Something that Kanye would have done between Graduation and 808s.
It sounds like Mike Dean, to be honest.
Yeah, or like the Twisted Whose Fantasy. Whose
fingerprints are all over this album.
Good Fridays so. Era, yeah. you know?
Right.
But I thought that was interesting because it almost predates the maximalist Kanye stuff.
Yeah, right. it does.
You know, now that I think of it, I mean, there could be an argument, I mean, to be made. Maybe Scarface was just going, like, maybe this was the original structure because, like I was saying, that Corleone line fits perfectly with that little break, that sound. So maybe he heard that and that brought to mind, like, you know, The Godfather.
Yeah.
You know, maybe. So possibly. I don't know.
Possibly. Or I mean, either, a lot of times producers, you'll take a beat off a beat tape. They still have the files. They could add shit to it once you have it. Once you buy the beat off of them, it's like, yo, could we get a bridge over here?
Right.
Right.
And it can be put in post. Basically, you just rework the beat a little bit.
Yeah.
So I just think it's interesting because Kanye beats of this time period, a lot of them, in hindsight, have a much rougher quality than a yeah, lot of people probably remember.
Right, which is why this threw me off, because when I hear, like, Guess Who's Back, I'm like, yeah, this sounds like Kanye.
I hear
like
the Rumble Pack drums on Guess Who's Back.
Yes. Right, the Rumble Pack drums. Whereas here, it sounded very clean, you know? Mm-hmm. So I'm like, Kanye? Like, really? You know? So, I mean, I don't want to make it something. Maybe he was a ghost producer and he put his name on it. I don't know.
Oh, he's always Who been knows? Good at giving credit. I mean, that's how we know about how little he actually does.
Oh, man. Oh, jeez. Okay. I wasn't going to take it that far, but all right.
I'm just saying, he's always been good at giving credit.
Yeah, that is true.
He's not shy with like crediting his writers and his co-producers and stuff like that.
I think part of the reason for that, though, is because like I think he's always eager to show off his taste. It's like, look who I work with, fam. You know, it's like, that seems like a very kind of, like, all, like including all of those credits is a, like a flex.
I think it's honestly just a way to ingratiate himself into the industry, but that's Kanye rankings. This is Scarface rankings right now.
Mm-hmm. Fair enough. Right. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I mean, look, it, lyrically, it's far beyond a 6+. I think my mind's going to change about this, you know, cause Kenny came in and like, apparently this is not so, foreign to Scarface's catalog. So
yeah, this is right up his alley.
Yeah. Okay. Huh. Yeah. Well, my mind could change, you know, but yeah, basically when I think of this record and how I've been thinking about it all week, you know, fitting title for the lyrics we got, it's just a very unflinching description of this life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like basically, and I think there's kind of a way I kind of want to look at it where it is like from verse one to the final verse is kind of a bit of a story. Like even though I started small time, which is apparently a callback, like he started small time. Verse two, he decides, yo, I'm gonna screw over dude and like, you know, step on to work. And, you know, come up off of him to three, like you could almost maybe infer they caught on to him and now he's on the run.
Right. You and know? There's a certain like fatalism he's gonna, in the yeah. writing.
This is right. The third verse is him at the table with the mountains of coke and Sosa's coming through. Sosa's
you know, coming through the right, window. Like they're coming to collect.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, you can look at it like that. And I'll say only a certain tier of rapper can, you know, give you a song that can have different interpretations like that. You know,
Scarface is an author. He's like a fucking crime novelist, basically, you know, like,
right.
The best.
You know, he's, and his voice, man. I mean, these are like
very distinctive to me, voice.
The diary is like an old time radio drama, but as a rap album, it's a story. It's a great novel, basically. But right. That'll be for another day. But before we go, I do want to talk a little bit about.
Oh, we so got what's the scenario? Yeah, absolutely.
One second. I got a hot take before we get there.
Oh, okay.
Sure.
I'm willing to put some money on this, but. For now, I will say, and I'll let you guys do your thing. But I'm going to state this for everyone to hear. I believe that Scarface has the best discography of all hip hop artists.
Wow!
If you include his work with the Ghetto Boys, so I'm going to be tuning in to hear what you guys have to rate all of his albums at whenever you guys get to them, including the Ghetto Boys. But I feel like it's unmatched. I don't think there's anyone in the game that has the longevity that he does, but also has the quality of work that each album he has. I mean, he has classics all around. It's quality work up and down his discography, and I don't see anyone matching it. So I just wanted to put that out there.
I mean, we will have to get to the bottom of that statistically yes. on this show. So, like,
eventually we'll know what everyone's discography overall, like, you know, average rating would be, essentially. Right. I'll say this. At one point in time, I would have been able to confidently say, nah, Ghostface Killa. But now, after the last 10 years, I don't know. I don't know anymore. Anything from Iron Man to Apollo Kids is open for discussion. Anything after Apollo Kids, other than maybe one thing, I might have to concede, you know? So we'll see. I'll think about it. But it's a hot take. Call in 718-635-0743. Do you agree? And if you don't, who would you posit has the best, most consistent discography in hip-hop? Not the highest highs, but they have 10 mid albums we don't want to talk about. Who is the yes. best discography? Every project of a certain caliber, quality bar. That's like, I think we can't even talk about Jay because of stuff like Kingdom Come and Blueprint 3.
Yeah.
Right. And we're talking from the 80s to now. So.
Right. Okay. I mean, it's very possible, you know? If you put, like, you average his entire discography out versus the average of someone else's, it's very possible. Because most artists have, like, those, you know, Jay's got those few weak spots. Like, most artists have them, yeah. You know?
Right. I guess someone could say Biggie, but that's kind of cheating, isn't it?
I would say so. I mean, Biggie has we two didn't albums, really get so.
Two albums yeah, so. Versus, you know, a whole career, basically.
Yeah.
We can't say Wayne anymore, you know? Like, that's gone. Can't say that anymore. That's just not true.
He reached that dreadful point where, like, there's more new bad stuff than there was good old stuff. So it, like, tips the scales a bit.
You know? Hey, it's a good conversation starter. And speaking of which, I got mine right here. It's what's the scenario?
Hip
hop debate game.
Hold on. I got the dice. They're right here. Yeah.
We got dice.
We got it.
Okay. We got cards here.
Yeah.
I had to actually, I brought the game to show my dad because, you know, I'm always trying to prove to him that I'm not a failure in life. I was like, we got our first sponsor. And we were out, like, eating at this, like, pancake house or something. I brought it, and, like, you know, he was going through the cards and everything. And I had to keep him from, like, turning up because he was ready to play right then and there and start some debates. And I'm like, well, I came for pancakes. But, yeah, but the potential of this game is through the roof. This was a no-brainer, you know, collaboration here. Like, you know, Kenny reached out and, you know, we got on a call and we talked like this. This is I've told him, like, you know, in that call, I want to say it here on the show. This is like the kind of game that I would dream about, you know, when I was 18, 19, like, yo, it would be dope if they found a way to gamify hip hop debate. Mm-hmm. And this is that game, you know, like. It is. So, and we will be playing it. You know, we'll figure out the specifics and how we'll pull it off technically, but we're going to be demonstrating for y'all. The thing with Mools and Mel is we're not just going to have a sponsor and not really be behind it, you know?
Right. But like, tell you that the meals taste delicious regardless.
No, that ain't what we came to do. And we're going to be sponsoring something. It's because we actually like it. So we will be playing the game soon. You'll be able to see for yourselves. I foresee probably at least once a season, we'll probably like have someone on to play the game with us, you know?
Yep. We're just trying to figure out the best way to do it remotely right now because of everything that's going on. And, you know, we've been working with Kenny behind the scenes to do some interesting things that hopefully we'll be able to talk about more in the future. But I want to give Kenny the floor to talk a little bit about the project, how it came about, and everything else that, you know, is involved with it. Because we do have, I believe, a special code for our listeners here.
Absolutely. And
I feel it's professional. We got a code and everything.
Absolutely. I guess I'll start with, you know, anyone who's not familiar with the game, how it's played. So I'll try to do a quick rundown of that. Basically, the game is broken down into two parts. So you have a white deck, and this white deck is comprised of a couple of different type of cards. And this is the deck that we basically use to play. But the most important card in the white deck is the scenario cards. So quickly, one scenario would be something like you're in a high-speed chase with the police after committing a bank robbery with adrenaline racing. Who are you listening to? So one person would pick this card and read it to everyone else. And everyone else would submit to that person a rapper card. So let's say, you know, we got T.I., Scarface, 50 Cent, and Playboi Carti. So the person who read that scenario would then, you know, choose between those options.
For example, I'd probably pick Cardi.
And I would
or 50 Cent.
I would go crazy if you pick Cardi for that. But that's the beauty of the game is that
we already got a debate
going. Yeah, the hell? But so the people who are submitting these rabbit cards then get to sort of argue their point of, you know, who that person should pick. That's the kind of the meat of the game is just that debate. So there's 90 different scenario questions like that in the game, and there's also 90 different rappers that you can choose from to have those type of debates and discussions. The other major part of the game is the battle portion. So in that white deck that I was speaking about, there's scenario cards. There's also So let me back up for a second. So let's say I put down Playboi Carti. So Mel, if you pick Playboi Carti, I would win the scenario card that you read, which is worth 2 points. So at the end of the game, we count up how many points you got. There's a couple of different ways to gain and lose points in the game, but that's essentially how the game runs through. The other part, the other important part is also in the white deck is discards. Those discards are worth -1 point, which gives you an incentive to actually use them. So if you have a pair of discards, what you can essentially do is diss someone. And with dissing someone, let's say, someone had 50 Cent and you didn't pick their card. They're upset at you. On their turn, they're going to diss you, Mel. So then, right. So then what will happen is each player starts off the game with 3 rapper cards. So this is where it gets interesting is that we call them sliders. They're also can be called categories or what have you. But each rapper card has these sliders on them. And the sliders are flow, delivery, rhyme, content, style, and catalog. So each rapper has a rating based on those particular sliders. And that's where the dice come in. So one person gets one dice, one person gets another one. And depending on what the role of the dice is, so if I roll flow and you roll style, we're going, 50 Cent versus Playboi Carti, the best out of 3 rounds would win that particular battle. So that's where it also gets interesting. There's a lot of people who agree and disagree with the ratings that are placed on the cards. People really get a kick out of winning with their rapper in their hand and beating people. That is the other aspect of the game that really gets people riled up, and it's really gets people interested in playing and competing with each other. So that's essentially what, there's other cool things in the game. There's a crown card where, if you win a battle, you get to have the crown. And then for the rest of the game, people are gunning for you because you have the crown. It's worth a certain amount of points. There's an ether card and a takeover card and, a couple of different, special cards. But the main point of the game is the scenarios and the battles. And that is what stirs up and spurs up a lot of the debate and discussion and arguments and fights, throughout the game. So it's I've created it, so I I'm supposed to say this, but I feel like you're not going to get a more fun experience discussing hip hop in a game form outside of this game. I feel like I try my best to keep it as true to what the culture is as possible and make it as interesting as possible. And like you guys just contributing, this is my contribution to the culture. So, I want people right. to appreciate it, and I want people to contribute to it, which is I can talk about it a little bit. One of the reasons why I reached out to you guys, because like I said, one of the sliders is the catalog slider. So, Rap Rankings fits perfectly in with that. And we'll, in the future discuss how we can incorporate, the Rap Rankings formula into our slider. for the rapper cards. So, you know, that's, you know, one of the cool things about this is that I want people to be able to contribute to it. This isn't, you know, this isn't some staple standalone ratings or, you know, or anything like that. I want this to be a community effort where everyone can get involved and contribute their input to these ratings and to the game in general, so that, you know, this can become something more than just a game. It's, you know, it can be a standard of how we discuss what we discuss when we discuss hip hop.
Exactly. Like that, what you just said, like the standard, like having a common ground to speak about these things, you know. Absolutely. The parameters are set, you know. It's like it's not like we see ourselves as the authority figures of hip hop. We're just trying to figure out how we can contribute to the culture in a way that allows for more fruitful discussions. Absolutely. To where we're all on an even playing field. So then we can go into
and put something of value, something that people can go back on and actually has some shelf life to it.
I think this game does a perfect job at capturing the spirit of hip hop debate and what makes it so fun and timeless and aggravating. And just like some of the best times of my life are getting riled up with my friends about rap.
Yeah, that's why we started this show. And I mean, I feel
there
like
you go.
If you have a group of friends and you guys are all into hip hop, this is like Rab in a box. You could be telling your friends, we know about you in no time. You just got to open up the banter. And this is a perfect platform for you to do so. It's a really fun, creative, and I must say, very well-designed game. It comes in really awesome packaging.
The production value is top-notch. The cards, they're sturdy. The dice are cool. The box is great. Like, I ain't just saying this.
Thank you.
You know, my dad agrees. And the thing about Kenny that attracted me to, you know, like opening the discussions between us was, you know, he kind of comes from the same background that we do. And he's not like this corporate suit advertiser guy that approaches us and is like, hey, I'd love to do some affiliate marketing with you guys. This is a guy who is really about his shit in terms of repping for the hip hop culture the way you should and contributing a product of value to the space. So I have to say, I'm personally very excited about what we have coming in the future. And I can't wait to start playing some of these games on stream with everyone. It's going to be a lot of fun.
Look, I'm looking forward to getting dunked on inevitably by my friends, because that's how every debate ends, with people ganging up on me. So I'm looking forward to it, though. It'll be fun.
Well, with this, you can, depending on what you have in your hand, you know, you can start busting some ass. Like, you get somebody, and then, you know, you
can
start
getting some battles
on your nut. Yeah, exactly.
This could be my chance. This could be playing. So what's
Mel busts
scenario?
Out the dojo and chance. Really starts putting numbers on the board. You have to say, know? Talk to me nice now, you know?
I'm going to have to tell him, listen.
What do you do? I ain't killing hip-hop nigga.
What do you do? I kill hip-hop nigga. Okay, because they think I killed hip-hop. They think Rab killed hip-hop. But listen, clearly Kenny sees merit in the rating system. You know, we're in the works figuring out how we could incorporate it. It's like, we clearly see merit in this, which is why we want to promote it. It's like, you know,
smash
hip-hop is about community, gosh darn it. All right. And I feel like that's what we're fostering here, you know, with this collaboration, by playing the game. It's the community of hip hop, you know. So
that's what it's all about.
So yeah, guys, stay tuned for some. So what's the scenario specific content? But if you want to pick up the game, you can go to sowhatgames.com, and I believe our affiliate code is Rab, RAB.
Yes. Yes, you get
so you guys will get a little discount on there. Free shipping. Yes,
free shipping when you use the code RAB, R-A-B.
This is one of the proudest moments of my life. I feel like I've really done something. You know, like, I got an affiliate code. Like, I'm trying not to get emotional on air. Just don't mind me. Don't mind me.
Listen, I'm just as honored as you guys are. This is great. It's great to see like-minded people out in the space doing something substantial and contributing to the culture in a way that makes sense. And it's original, it's unique, it's creative. So I feel like I'm doing the same thing. So it's like, hey, like let's see if we can make something happen together. We can, you know, we can put our communities together and, you know, make this stronger. So
absolutely.
Well, I'll say in the words of that boy Rick in Casablanca, I think this is the beginning of a beautiful friendship.
Wow. Okay.
So that's sowhatgames.com. Enter code RAB at checkout for free shipping. And stay tuned. We have some awesome stuff on the way. But Kenny, do you have anything else you'd like to plug? Anywhere people can find you? Floor is yours.
Like we just said, sowhatgames.com is where I want you to go. So that's where you should go. You can find me on the socials at IISCRAP, IISCRAPP. That's Twitter, Instagram, where have you. But sowhatgames.com. Use promo code RAB for free shipping. And that's what it's all about.
Wow.
There we go. Folks, we will be back right after this record scratch, or perhaps right after this new So What's the Scenario ad break.
Oh, wow. Well, I mean, that would kind of be redundant to place it here, because they just,
I suppose put it you're somewhere right. else. All right, next week.
Okay.
All right, folks.
What would this show be without me? I keep his head in the game, you know?
No, Tyrant Mules. I'm trying to, let's crank as much capital out as we possibly can, you know? This boat doesn't run on steam alone.
This man ran an ad right after the ad.
Fuck it.
Essentially.
It's the new way of ad placement. It's the new advanced way.
Oh, brother. All right. Anyway. Well, listen, it's been a pleasure. Thanks for having I almost said thanks for having us on. I'm tripping. All right.
Thank you guys for having me on.
Hey, no problem.
Hey, man. No, anytime. Ours. And I'm sure we'll be talking again. I think when we do this big, so what's the scenario game on the feed? You should be with us, you know, and join us for a very lively affair.
Definitely. I would love that.
Well, we'll talk more off air. Thanks again, Kenny. We'll talk to you soon.
Nice. Peace.
Yo, it's Mel from Rap Rankings. To hear the full episode this clip comes from and all the other episodes, stop by raprankings.com or search Rap Rankings on your favorite podcast platform.